Everybody ready?
Would you bang it out?
Okay. All right, I am gaveling to order this meeting of the Common Council for Carmel, Indiana for tonight, February 6, 2023. We have a quorum. Everyone is here. I would first ask for a motion to approve our agenda as sent out.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, it's been properly seconded. Would everyone please vote? Jacob, I don't have view of that, so I'll have to. You'll have to tell me. I'm going to assume that.
Still need to vote, Councillor Finkham and Councillor Hannon.
Oh, they're having a meeting.
Guys need to vote.
Can you vote, please?
Nine zero.
Thank you. All right, we will move next to our invocation, and Pastor Ben Snyder of Carmel Friends Church is here. Thank you, Pastor, for taking your time to join us tonight.
Thank you for having me. Good evening, friends. Please join me for a word of prayer. Loving God, we thank you for the time that you've given us and the place that you've put us. Lord, we pray tonight that we would be mindful of your divine presence in our midst. Keep us mindful of those who are represented by this council tonight. Bless those who serve and those who are served. Help us to seek justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Have a wonderful meeting.
Thank you. Yep. Thank you, Pastor. All right, if everyone would please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. Councilor Green.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, thank you. Tonight, it is our honor and privilege to be able to swear in two new police officers, three police officers. I'll now turn it over to Chief.
Good evening, Council. Jim Barlow, Carmel Police Department. Exactly what Jeff has said, I'm proud to have three very new police officers. At least they're new to us. We're lucky enough, we have three officers that are laterals, so they have years of experience and knowledge that they're gonna bring to the city of Carmel. They all formerly worked for the Indianapolis Police Department. I'd like to have Carlton Howard, Clifton Hogue, and Ethan Carr come up front here.
Solemnly swear that I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of Indiana.
And the Constitution of the State of Indiana.
And I will faithfully and impartially discharge my duties.
I will faithfully and impartially discharge my duties.
As a police officer of the City of Carmel, Indiana.
As a police officer of the City of Carmel, Indiana.
According to the law.
According to the law.
Best of my ability.
And to the best of my ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations. We wish all of our officers, especially our new officers, safety as they protect the citizens of Carmel and carry out their duties. Thank you to each of them. Thank you, Chief Barlow. Next on our agenda is recognition of persons who wish to address the council. We have one blue card, Charlie Demler. Charlie, if you want to go ahead and, Councillor Finkham, will you make, okay, I think it's on.
Hi, Charlie Demler, 463 Emerson Road. I think all of you know me, but my new representative. Nice to meet you. Basically, I just had a question. I understand you can't answer it, but I know when the whole AT&T, Pure Development, and Buckingham and all that got approved, there was a TIF of, I believe, $23 million. And since at least Pure Development has pulled out of that, I wanted to find out that it seemed to me that that TIF money is going to be reduced, and I just wanted to find out who could give me that answer at some point. Thank you.
All right, thank you. I have no other blue cards. Thank you, Mr. Demler. Next up, I want to take a moment to welcome our newest member of the Common Council of this body, Councillor Teresa Ayers. This is her first meeting, and we are happy to have you. She was sworn in earlier this evening by Judge Campbell, and so let's give her a round welcome, warm applause. And I also wanted to thank Councillor Campbell for covering for me last month when I could not be here. But it's now my honor, as we traditionally do, we recognize the outgoing president. So Councillor Ryder, if you please rise. And we just have a plaque from all of us here, and I'll just read it real quick. Carmel Common Council President Kevin Woody Ryder, in gratitude and recognition for valuable service and exemplary leadership to your council colleagues and the citizens of Carmel. Congratulations and thank you for your service.
Thank you very much.
Okay, next we will move on to the consent agenda. We're going to approve the minutes for January 9th, 2023, as well as January 25th, 2023. Claims in the amount of payroll, $3,445,784.18, and general claims in the amount of $1,750,233.88.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right. Hearing that, please vote. Next up are, that motion carries. Next up are committee reports. The Finance, Utilities, and Rules Committee has not met. Councillor Campbell, land use and special studies, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. Our committee met on January 25th to discuss Ordinance Z-679-22, which amends the 2022 Legacy PUD. This will come back with a 4-0 favorable recommendation, and I can go into detail when it comes up on our agenda.
Great. Thank you, Councillor Campbell. Next up is the monthly meeting of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission. Director Mesteski, would you please come forward?
Good evening, Council. First, I'm happy to answer Mr. Demler's question that was asked during the blue card period. He asked what happens with the AT&T development if a portion of it can't move forward. Because this is a developer TIF, the city's not on the hook for any of the TIF amount, any of the bond amount that City Council previously approved. And a majority of development is still within the C-zoned area. and is going to move forward, as I understand it. So the developer is going to receive less TIF on their bond, but because the developer is on the hook for that and not the city, it won't affect the city in any way. Is a quick answer to that question.
All right, thank you. All right, proceed with your report. Unless there are any questions from council, no.
There was an article in the New York Times just at the end of last month called America the Bland that I thought was a, it was a nuanced article, and I thought it would be worth mentioning during my report this month. Essentially, it's an article about how 4-over-1 development, which is four stories of stick-built construction on top of a concrete podium, is being built across the United States, which is generally a good thing, but cities are not focusing on architecture. And because that's also happening here in Carmel's core, I thought it was a nuanced approach to see how what Carmel has been doing in its TIF projects is different. Essentially, the article talks about how these 4-over-1 projects with ground floor retail, often featuring vivid slabs of bright paneling that you see, and this is anywhere you go in any big city, you see a lot of these. It's a bulky design that is conspicuous throughout, frankly, all new development that's happening. The 4-over-1 concept in itself is not a bad thing. Housing advocates say that it's providing housing when it's and affordable housing when that is incredibly needed throughout the United States. But in most of these cities, the design takes a back seat to the necessity of the project itself. They call this, that picture right there actually is not that bad. They call these Lego structures. They call it any town architecture. The gist of this article is while it's good to have housing and it's good to have these projects, they are the same in every city. And when you look at architecture, you can't tell what city it's from. Quote at the bottom, they're like Denny's. You could be at a Denny's in Iowa or New Mexico or Colorado, and you wouldn't know where you are. It's just Denny's. In the article, they went to, they almost play a game of, they are showing a bunch of these, again, same architecture. Can you guess what city the specific piece of architecture is in? It all has these, this paneling. It all has this very bland, almost a color paint by numbers type of facade that happens in all these cities. And these projects are happening everywhere. Here's another example where they ask in this article, which one of these buildings is in Seattle? I like the quote, look, big cities, or really all cities, should be inspiring. Cities should feel like a work of art, and that's important. Again, people understand that, you know, some argue that getting housing built is more important than nitpicking over aesthetics. But the aesthetics are a big deal. I can't tell which city each specific picture noted there belongs in. And I think that is a general problem. Everywhere in America is beginning to look exactly the same, with the exact same type of projects. Again, it's a positive that there's more housing, but current construction misses an opportunity. And so I just think with that kind of backdrop, projects approved by Carmel City Council here, TIF projects that we do, are not this same exact type of Lego with bright paneling facades that we see populating the country as a whole. That's an example of the corner currently under construction at 116th and Rangeline. That's not the same as everywhere else. That's a beautiful, architecturally beautiful brick facade. In our city center, that's 4-over-1. That's first floor commercial with four floors of residential above it. But we pay attention to cornice lines, we pay attention to balconies, we pay attention to architectural details, and that sets Carmel apart. Proscenium is another example. That building right there on the left, it has a Art Deco vibe to it on the left. That's a strong corner there. That picture's dated. That art has been moved. I will mention that. That's right. You should have used a more updated picture. As opposed to what you see on the right, quoted, pictured in the article, but really that's a building that if you travel across the United States, they're everywhere. The signature under construction now at Old Meridian Main Street is going to have this kind of twin tower architectural detail that's going to set it apart. The concourse is another example of really beautiful, beautiful architecture compared to what we see. I'm not going to mention any of our neighbors, but you see them everywhere. These kind of panelings, the fake corrugated metal, random details. Again, this project approved by council recently is on the south side of Old Meridian, Maine. And it's if you zoom in, it's all brick, and there's fancy brickwork, and there's nice cornice lines, and it doesn't look like the same stuff everywhere. Probably my favorite example of this, I took a picture when I was in Austin, Texas. So from an urban planning standpoint, this project is amazing. It has a garage in the middle. It has a Whole Foods and a Micro Target. I mean, that's a project we would kill for here. But then there's the architecture. Like, what is that? Why did somebody think any of this is a good idea? And why did the city planners allow this kind of architecture to move forward? And so as one of the things that we, it's really gross. I mean, I don't know why it looks like that. Why was this okay? Why was this built? They really wanted a Micro Target, I guess. It's just the article is poignant, and it just points out how hard our urban planning department, Mike Hallbaugh's department, the Redevelopment Commission, and everyone here works to make sure that our projects have architectural details that are striking and significant. So when you're walking along the Monon and Carmel, you know that that's Carmel, and not every town USA, which is what this article kind of points out. One of the things that I sometimes show to developers when I first see initial rendering of a potential project is this meme. Developer modernism, don't do this. Don't do the same thing that every town is doing across the United States. Carmel is different. And our architecture is just one way that we strive to set ourselves apart. With that, I'm happy to do the usual reports, the same stuff as usual, or I can answer any questions, or I can cut it short, whatever council desires.
Yeah, why don't you go ahead? Is there anything noteworthy that needs to be updated in your report of your projects?
Not really.
Okay. All right, does council have any questions? First to my left, any questions for Director Misteski? All right, anyone to the right? Well, all right, thank you for your report.
Thank you.
Next, we're gonna move on to 11H, which is the annual report for the Ethics Board, which occurs always on Friday. Mr. Oberlander will make that report.
Good evening, Council. John Oberlander, Corporation Counsel. Thanks for having me here tonight. I'm here on behalf of the Carmel Ethics Board, as you said, for our annual report. I'm happy to report there were no ethics complaints filed with the board in 2022. Regarding the 2021 statements of economic interest, in accordance with Section 284 of City Code, the SEIs were distributed by my office in early March of last year to all full-time, part-time, seasonal city employees, as well as the mayor, clerk, counselors, and all members of city boards and commissions. We received 232 responses. We'd sent out about 1,015, but keep in mind that a response isn't required unless you actually have a statement of economic interest to disclose. So when you receive it next month, or in a couple of weeks, if you don't have anything to disclose, you don't have to answer. You don't have to send a response. As I said, we're currently preparing to send the notice out to all appropriate persons for 2022, as we do this in arrears. And those should go out within the next couple of weeks. Please note that the statement of economic interest is only related to the city's ethics code. So filing this statement, if you file a statement of economic interest, it doesn't relieve you of a duty to file a conflict of interest disclosure that would be required by Indiana state law. They have a bit different subject matter and reporting requirements. So if you have any questions, let me know. But that's all I had for my report. Happy to answer any questions.
All right, very good. Thank you, Mr. Oberlander. Any questions regarding ethics? Councilor Hannon.
Mr. Oberlander, I know this is an HR question, but I know our newish HR director is standardizing policies and procedures and training. I certainly want to make sure, and with your input, that we have ethics and conflict of interest modules within that HR training. Is that available now, or do you happen to know?
They're still working on the rollout. This is all going to be done through NeoGov, and there's several different training modules for all different types of employee training, and I'll talk to Director Hartz, and I can apprise you of what's actually in there, and I'd be happy to consult with her on that, too.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Oberlander. Appreciate the update. Next, we'll move on to 11J, which is Parks Department. Director Klitzing.
Screen just goes blank.
Is Henry still here? No, he's not. Do you have to hit a toggle up on your function keys?
Historically, I haven't.
Henry, would you mind showing Mr. Klitzing if there's any secret to getting the screen to work, please?
It usually just takes a second.
I know.
There we go.
Yeah, we have a member. I apologize. Let's call in the cavalry.
Positive.
Excellent. Thank you.
Good evening, members of the council. Michael Klitzing, director of Carmel Clay Parks and Recreation. As always, pleased to come before you tonight to give my quarterly report of a little bit about last year and some of our successes from 2022, as well as some projects that are in the lineup for this year. Talking a little bit about revenues, and I haven't done this relatively recently, but I thought it would be good to kind of talk about pre and post COVID. 2019 was actually one of our most successful years that we had at Carmel Clay Parks and Recreation, especially as it pertains to our enterprise operations, the Monon Community Center, Extended School Enrichment, which involves the before and after school program and summer camps, as well as what we call recreation facilities, which is predominantly the dog park, but also includes our two satellite facilities in Founders Park, as well as West Park, and all the shelters that are available for rental throughout the parks. So combined, those operations in 2019 had approximately $11.4 million in revenue, gross revenue, and we netted right about $1 million, which up to that point was our best year that we had ever had. And then COVID, $6.1 million, $2.7 million loss in those operations. We've reported that to you before. It was the first year since 2009 that we did not achieve 100% cost recovery with our enterprise operations. That happened to be the 2010 was the first year that the Monon Community Center was completely self-sufficient, and that was only its third year of operations. Fortunately, 2021, we did rebound, not all the way back to 2019, but we did finish in the black with about $500,000 net income off of $7.7 million in revenue. I'm pleased to report last year that while we're not all the way back, we're pretty close, $10.9 million, and we actually had our best net that we've ever had as a park system at $1.8 million. So very pleased with the operations that we have, the staff that have worked diligently, the painful changes that we at times had to make regarding staffing and overall operations to meet the realities of today's market. But we've certainly been very successful at that, and 2023 in the first month has gotten off to a good start as well. There's some metrics that I look at pretty closely as far as how we're doing, and of course cost recovery rate, which for us is our operational revenues for those enterprise operations I just explained, divided by their expenses. So again, every year since 2010, these numbers have been green with the exception of 2020 where we had 70% cost recovery. Those relate directly to the previous slide that I gave you. Another metric that I look at is our cash reserves. So for each of those enterprises, they operate out of non-reverting funds. So the revenues that we collect, as long as we make a net, those stay within the fund and serve for a variety of purposes. First, we need to make sure that we have enough funds reserves to basically cash flow our operations. We're a very seasonal operation. A lot of our revenues, especially with the Monon Community Center, are tied to the water park. So we have a lot of that coming in during the summer months. We have a huge spike of revenue right before summer into summer from the summer camp operations. So we need to make sure that in those months where we maybe don't necessarily for that month break even, that over the course of the year we have the funds to pay the bills, and we consistently do. The other thing that we use cash reserves for are for rainy days and for unexpected expenses, none greater than COVID-19. So fortunately, I usually try to make sure that our cash reserves ideally are at 70% or higher. That allows us to ensure that we have enough for cash flow as well as those unexpected expenses. We also tried to grow those over the years. So in 2018, we were actually closer to 80% with our cash reserves. We grow those expenses so that we have funds available to reinvest into those operations. So for example, in 2019 and 2020, we spent collectively about $1.8 million. Those were collected reserves in our ESE fund, 108 fund, from our summer camps that were ultimately used to help pay the construction of the Jill Perlman Pavilion in West Park. There are no summer camps anywhere in the country that are able to help build the buildings in which they are constructed, but we do it here in Carmel, and that's because of the cash reserves that we ultimately build up from the net revenues we generate. Again, if we get below 70%, then that assures that if we have a dramatic year like COVID-19 in 2020, that we have the resources that we don't have to come to this body to request a tax subsidy to fund our operations. We were able to use our reserves to get through the rainy days, the rainy months, the rainy year, to be able to, again, be back in the black and operating where we are. 2021, we brought the reserves back up to 66%. You notice that we spent no dollars those years. We wouldn't have spent any dollars in 2020. Those were carryovers from the previous year. In 2022, we also didn't spend any of our cash reserves for capital reinvestment solely to ensure that, again, we're building it up. But what we'll be able to do here in the future, presuming 2023 continues on the same path, is that some of those funds will help us, for example, build the indoor playground that I previously reported in my last quarterly report, or help us to build the next pavilion that will ideally be constructed in Bear Creek Park. So, you know, we're in solid grounds and continue to look very positive. But I just wanted to share some of the metrics that I do look at very closely that help me demonstrate that we truly are a sustainable park system, especially from a financial perspective. In 2022, you know, looking at where our revenues are coming from, you know, $11.1 million was earned income. The vast majority of that were the revenues I just talked about. The difference between what I reported for the enterprise and these are donations that we received as well as interest earned on our accounts. We received $4.9 million from the City of Carmel, which funds our general fund. That's paying for all of our general administrative expenses, not for any staff that are employed or used to operate the Monon Community Center or Extended School Enrichment, but you know, positions like my own, HR, those types of functions, as well as for maintenance of our parks. All those areas that we provide and are important for us to provide within the parks, the upkeep of and mowing of the parks, the landscape, all of that is paid out of the $4.9 million from the city. We received last year $3.6 million from Clay Township. This is all from the local income tax dollars that are attributable to the Central Park bond, and they're dedicated under the interlocal agreement between the city and the township for park capital projects. So those are used to help build the things within the parks and as well as do renovations. And then we received last year just under $0.8 million from impact fees. These are the fees that are paid for new residential development and the fees that came to benefit parks. As I've mentioned to the City Council in the past, as the community for traditional development within subdivisions starts to dwindle as the land is ate up, the impact fees that are coming towards parks will continue to dwindle. The year before, we had over $1 million. This is the least amount that we've had over the last 5 years. And again, that doesn't necessarily surprise me just because the development isn't happening to as great of extent on the east and west side of towns as it is in the central part. So that's something that we knew about, and that's why it's important for us to look at new funding sources for the park system for the capital development. And just to sort of illustrate it, you know, last year we received under $1 million to build all of Bear Creek Park based on the master plan that was developed with public input. That park is a little under $30 million. Based on the master plan for Thomas Marcuselli Nature Park in the northeast corner, again, that's about a $25 to $30 million park. So $1 million a year or dwindling is certainly not going to do much to help build those parks. So why we have to look at other funding sources. So some highlights from last year. Thanks to the Clay Township Impact Program, we did finish and open the renovation of four of our parks, Lawrence W. Inlow Park on the east side, Meadowlark Park here in the central core, River Heritage Park also on the east side, touching the river, just north of 116th Street, and of course West Park, one of our regional parks on the west side of town. Some key numbers, visitors, customers served through our programs and facilities. Just under 580,000 visitors to the Monon Community Center and Water Park. We had just under 108,000 participants in our programs, predominantly at the Monon Community Center. The vast majority of those are actually participants in our group fitness programs, about 94,000. The rest are in our recreation, aquatics, and similar types of programs. Within our summer camps, we had just under 7,000 enrolled camp participants in last year's camps. And last school year, we had a little under 2,100 enrolled participants in the before and after school program. And while not customers served, residents that have helped contribute and serve the park system in our greater community, we had over 3,357 volunteer hours contributing to parks. The vast majority of that was for environmental stewardship projects, the removal of invasive species, park cleanups, those types of things. Some of the next largest category of volunteer hours is towards our adaptive programs, so programs that serve people with disabilities, so assistants that help us provide those programs. So very successful year in 2022. So something that we're going to be starting this year is, as I believe all of you are aware, we have a comprehensive Parks and Recreation Master Plan, which guides the development and management of the park system. Our current master plan is actually designed to go through 2025, but based on the dramatic changes that have impacted the park system, thanks largely to COVID-19, as well as the tremendous success that we've had in implementing a lot of the capital components within the current master plan, working with the park board, we decided that it was appropriate to update the master plan a year earlier because the old plan in many ways is now obsolete. And we want to make sure that we're attuned to the expectations of the park system today, not based on the input that we had that predated 2019. Certainly a lot of changes since then. So what's important about the comprehensive master plan is that it incorporates a number of assessments and input that is done before we develop the plan. The plan is significantly developed based on community input. We do a statistically valid community survey so that we understand broadly what residents want and like about the park system, as well as challenges that they might see. We have a number of stakeholder interviews with members of the council, with the township board, and with other community leaders to get an understanding of what their expectations are about the park system. Again, what they like and things where we can potentially better improve to serve the community. We have focus groups with user groups and non-user groups to understand what we're, again, what we're doing well and where we can better serve the community. And in this master plan, we're going to do a special outreach to groups that maybe have been historically underserved by the park system or newer to the community that don't come to that traditional meeting that's at 6 p.m. in the evening. We're looking to go to the churches and synagogues and mosques to understand, you know, what their parishioners and members are thinking about parks and how they might use the parks. We're talking to newer residents that maybe have immigrated to the United States that maybe use parks differently than someone that's been in the United States a little bit longer. So that's all going to be part of the input process for this new comprehensive master plan. There'll be an asset conditions assessment, so you know, what condition are all of our parks and facilities in? Now, fortunately, because of the significant upgrades that we've made thanks to the Clay Township Impact Program, this should be one of the easiest lifts because most of our parks are in tremendous conditions because they've just recently been renovated. But we'll be looking at that, updating the asset plan that we previously had developed with the current master plan and making sure that we understand what the capital needs are for replacements and repairs of the existing assets. And then we'll also be doing a core services assessment. You know, what are and should be our core services? You know, we'll take a look and are the things that we're providing the right things to provide, or are there things that we're doing that are no longer necessary for Carmel Clay Parks and Recreation to do? I'll use an example from the past. Before, in the early days of the park system, we provided a lot of the community events within the city of Carmel and Clay Township. You'd go to kids' concerts in our parks or movies or different types of activities. But as the central core was development and specific event space was created, like Carter Green and Midtown Plaza and the Monon Boulevard, more and more of those events drifted towards the central part of the city and were events that were facilitated largely by the city of Carmel. And it has always been the park system's goal to serve underserved needs within the community. So if the need is being served in a different area, is it necessarily the best use of dollars to compete with those very specific events? Or is there a way to redirect those funds towards more needed services within the community? And what we chose to do is get out of special events, support the city in those, but what we instead do have increased our environmental stewardship programming and hired natural resources staff, which is definitely a core service of the park system. So we'll have those conversations and in the community input ask, what are the things that we're doing that we should continue to do? What are the things that we're doing that we should consider not doing, if any? And what are the things that we're not doing today that should be a core service of the park system? So that'll all be part of the front end of the master plan to understand what should be in the comprehensive master plan, where we establish the priorities, goals, and objectives of the park system for the next five-year time frame. And then emanating from the plan will be our revised capital improvement plan. You know, based on those priorities, what should we be developing and what are our capital funding needs for new improvements or renovations within the park system? Building off of that is an update to the zone improvement plan, which by law has to be updated at least every 5 years. And for us, it's very important that the zone improvement plan and the capital improvement plan be built off the input we're receiving from the comprehensive master plan. They're all part and partial, and those smaller plans are actually included as appendices within the overarching master plan. This time, we also will be doing business plans specifically for extended school enrichment and the Monon Community Center, updating documents that are now aged and again, worthy of being updated to ensure that we continue to meet the needs of our paying customers because they're spending their discretionary time and income with us, and we need to make sure that our plans are reflective of that so that we can manage accordingly. So you'll be hearing me talk about the master plan a lot more this year. You'll be seeing invites from me or from my staff inviting you to various meetings or keeping you posted as to updates. But wanted to get this in front of you now so that you're not surprised or wondering what the heck I'm yammering about for the course of the rest of the year. Our goal is to have this completed, approved by the Park Board before the end of the year. We will have at least two joint meetings with the City Council, the Township Board, and the Park Board. One on the front end to kind of talk about all the input information we received, and then one on the back end before we finalize the plan to make sure that the goals and priorities that we're establishing are consistent with the community leaders' goals and priorities as well. So that'll all be forthcoming. Some additional updates, and I'll go over these very quickly. As mentioned at the last one, thanks to a $4 million ready grant from the Indiana Economic Development Corporation, we will be extending the White River Greenway from where it currently ends all the way to 146th Street. This is in collaboration with Connor Prairie, which will be granting us an easement for about half of the trail. So we're very excited about that. Incorporated within that is a trailhead that'll be just south of the elementary school there, as well as a great scenic overlook of the river, which will actually be looking over towards Connor Prairie and a very naturalized area as well. So it will be a very scenic place for residents to check out. Additionally, we will be expanding the trail network, filling in the gaps so that River Heritage Park, which was just reopened with the trail loops that we have there, is connected ultimately to the county's River Road Park, and ultimately that'll all be designated as part of the White River Greenway. Both of those projects are anticipated to have construction start this year. The southern leg is a pretty short one, so I think there's a good chance that that will still open before the end of this year. The northern leg, which is over 2 miles, includes a little bit trickier terrain, so that one will likely not open until 2024, but both of those projects will be started this year. I'm also grateful to Hamilton County, which has given us an additional $1 million grant based on us receiving the ready grant of $4 million, which will be used for enhancements envisioned along the trail, creating some more natural areas, wetlands, to make the north extension a little bit more scenic and interesting, all done in collaboration with Connor Prairie, since a good portion of that will be on their property. Going a little bit further south along the river corridor, but staying on the east side, last Monday I had a presentation to the Carmel Clay School Board to discuss a proposal that the park system has towards schools. There's roughly 50 acres of an 80-acre partial Main Street and River Road that the Carmel Clay School District owns. We are proposing and floated the idea of using that as a location for our second dog park. As we well know, there's over 600 dogs on our waiting list, so there's significant demand. So we're looking for additional locations, both on the east and west sides, to better address those needs. This property has also the ability to potentially build a community garden, which is something that was identified as an interest of residents in our last comprehensive master plan. And we always know our number one interest from the community is more trail experiences. With the wooded areas and the sports fields that the school district and Dad's Club have developed to the south portion of that property, there's an ability to create a nature trail loop system in there. If the school board is currently considering that, if they have a consensus, it doesn't guarantee approval of this or that it's moving forward, but it would be authorization to allow us to do our next step, which is to solicit community input to see if this is something that is practical and well-received, to take any feedback to make it a better plan. Based on that feedback, we'll take it back to the school board and also to the park board for ultimate approval, presuming everything goes favorable. So I can't give you a specific timeline on this, but the goal is if the school board ultimately consents to this, which I'm optimistic they will, we'll start that public input process this spring or summer at the latest. Also, in partnership with Carmel Clay Schools, we are looking at some property of theirs that is undeveloped on the north side of Carmel Elementary School, immediately south of the new parking structure for Carmel Clay Library. public library. The area looks like it actually is part of the library, but it is owned by the school district. One of the things, our original goals as we were working with the city and the township on expanding the Japanese garden, the stormwater components here south of City Hall, was maybe making that a sister cities garden where we could recognize all of our sister cities. It was ultimately determined that it was best to keep that space a Japanese garden and maybe find other ways to recognize the other sister cities. The first one that was being considered was the Chinese Garden. Carmel Clay Parks agreed to sort of take the lead at maybe trying to find a location, working very closely with the city. And one possible location that we identified, working closely with Mike Hollaball and DOCS, is this property highlighted in red. Again, this school board would ultimately have to grant the authorization for us to do so, but what we would envision is developing a park here that celebrates the Chinese culture and our vibrant Chinese community as well as our sister city in Hubei. And what we are doing, presuming the school board gives the consent to continue the exploration, the planning for this, we have had discussions on getting ready to execute an agreement with Purdue University in the Landscape Architecture Program to bring in a professor that is actually originally from Hubei, as well as some of her students to help lead the public input process. One of those students is actually a graduate of Carmel High School. And they will be soliciting the feedback, having some discussions with the Chinese community, doing a survey to identify what this space could look like. Again, based on that feedback, we'll present a plan to the school board. If they're amenable to that and agree to that, it'll also go to the park board for their consent. Now, one caveat I will put to this. While Carmel Clay Parks and Recreation agreed to help lead the planning, and ultimately, if we're successful in developing it, the long-term maintenance of this incredible asset, we do not have any dedicated funding for this. So we would be looking either to the city or private sources to help fund the development of that. So that was a condition that I put up front when talking with city administration with this. I do not have any dedicated funds. It's not part of the master plan, but it is something that would be an incredible asset for this community. Jumping to Central Park, as also previously reported, we've already issued the contract, and this spring we'll be completing the last loop of, or last segment to create a true loop around the lagoon in the west side of Central Park. So this will create approximately 1.4 mile trail, paved trail, completely around the water and wetlands so that someone can actually do that loop and never have to cross the interior drive within the park. So should be a well-received amenity. Construction will start this spring. It shouldn't take too long, so I would anticipate residents will be able to enjoy it beginning this summer. And then jumping to the west side of town, also as previously reported, we are currently out to bid for completing the missing link, if you will, of the existing perimeter trails along 116th Street, so it'll connect into the temple that's just south of West Park, where there's trails that take you all the way to Shelburne and beyond, and within the interior trails that already exist and perimeter trails that go beyond it connecting to Town Road. So providing critical connectivity to West Park, which has been one of the top requests that I know the city has received and certainly the park system has received too. Also, a separate project but on the same timeline is the construction of three additional shelters within West Park closer to where the playground is. Ultimately five there, but we're looking at building the first three now. One of the things that we did when we did the renovation project in West Park, the large shelter that's now immediately adjacent to the playground is designated as a community shelter, meaning it's open to the entire community and never available for rent. It's fully integrated. It provides a place for shade for visitors to it and first come, first serve. We knew that was one of our most popular shelters for family reunions and other events, so we are now constructing three larger shelters to more than replace the one that's now designated as a community shelter. And last but not least, March 1st will be the date that registration opens for our very popular summer camps. Many of the camps sell out within minutes. Many, the other ones within hours or within several days. And then there's a few that go a little bit longer. But March 1st is enrollment time. There's early enrollment for existing kids and families that are enrolled in the ESE program. So that starts at, I believe, 8 a.m. And then for the general population, the enrollment starts at noon. All that information is available on our website, carmelclayparks.com. So all the class, all the camps and all the details to get your kids enrolled is available at carmelclayparks.com. With that, I'd be happy to address any questions the council may have.
Thank you, Director Klitzing. Councilor Finkham.
First of all, bravo on a rocking presentation. That was fantastic. Everything you demonstrated is what an effective department should do in a world-class city.
Thank you.
You had an overview of how you use community input to make decisions. You had a description of your data and how you did over the years. So it was very transparent on your operations. You're very proactive on your planning. Bravo. If that was an NBA, that'd be a backboard smashing slam dunk. Congrats. I mean, really,
you make
our job so easy when you come in and give a presentation like that. I have two questions for you. One, do you have the permits and the timeline for the overlook?
The overlook and the White River
and then the path going forward. Do you have that set yet? Are we still waiting for the state?
We're still going through the permitting for that.
Okay.
So very much. Actually, we're still finishing the design. I believe within about a month, it'll be going to the state for permitting. So obviously,
okay,
that's going to be our critical path as to when we can start construction.
And then you said that was pending that. I wasn't sure where you're in that process,
right.
So thank you for that. Second of all, just a passing on information, I got slightly chastised for not having pickleball in West Park. So the struggle is real, but thank you for continuing to look for ways and places for that sport to grow in our community.
Absolutely. And I will note that Bear Creek Park, which would be a good reason for us to find funding for it, does have the ability for sports courts based on the public input we received. When we did the most recent master plan for West Park, there wasn't strong support for any types of sports courts within West Park. So very strong nature focus within that park.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the reason they're not there, but obviously demand continues to evolve, and that's what the master planning process is about.
Thank you.
Councilor Green.
Thanks, Mr. President. Tons of questions about the comprehensive plan and all the great ideas you probably have for new funding sources for capital improvements. We'll be talking about that over the next 8, 9, 10 months. I won't get into that. But you had the slide on usage. How's that usage today compared to pre-COVID? I mean, you had other numbers, but yeah, how's that compared to pre-COVID?
So our usage at the Monon Community Center and Water Park is right about where we were pre-COVID. Our membership at the Monon Community Center is about 90% of pre-COVID. And I will tell you, pre-COVID, we were busting at the seams. Our pre-COVID numbers were all-time highs. So 90% is not bad, because 90% is higher than most of the years before 2019. So very, very pleased with how that participation rates. Our program participation is maybe down ever a bit so slightly, not in group fitness. It has rebounded again. It's probably almost 100% pre-COVID numbers. Our other recreation programs, we found some changes in how people are using programs. Some of the things where there used to be demand, the demand hasn't completely returned yet. So that's truly driven by demand, not us offering. There's some programs that we've cut, but there's some programs that the demand just hasn't completely come back. But we're pretty close to pre-pandemic numbers. And definitely, if you compare us to like 2016, 2014, we're above those years.
All right, thanks. Now, before a few slides before this, you had the gross revenues pre-COVID and today. You had 11.4 and the 10.9. So we're closing the gap on the gross revenues. But then I drop down, I look at net income. We're doing really well on net income compared to where we were. So kind of disconnect. Did we take a lot of cost-cutting measures and we haven't completely kind of cut those off?
So a couple components there. We did do some cost-cutting measures. So, for example, immediately following, or while we were in the midst of COVID, we used to have a full-time assistant site supervisor in each of our school locations, each of the 11 elementary schools. Those positions were initially cut. We've been slowly bringing those positions back. I think we're about six or seven assistant site supervisors that we've brought back. So not all of those have returned. Now, at the same time, we've had to cap enrollment in the before and after school program because of difficulty in finding part-time staff, which is what drives most of our employment. I mean, we have 68 full-time employees, which is about 10 down still, a little under 10 down from pre-pandemic times. But we, you know, ideally we need about 400, and we're around 350 part-timers right now. So part of the reason our net is so good is there's a number of part-time positions that we were not able to fill. If we were able to fill them, it'd be closer to the $1 million. It wouldn't be all the way to the million. It'd probably be more 1.4 as opposed to 1.8.
No, thanks. And that was going to be my next question, which you answered about staffing.
Yeah.
I see lots of new faces.
Yes.
I was just wondering, but thanks.
Absolutely. So if anyone is looking for a part-time job, carmelclayparks.com. We also do have a fun retire program going right now. There was the unretire, and there's no better place to unretire if you're recently retired and just want to come back than to Carmel Clay Parks and Recreation, where you can fun retire.
All right. Any other questions for Director Klitzing? Great job. Thank you for the wonderful report. Keep up the great work.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right, we will move on now to old business. Item 12A is the fifth reading of Ordinance D-2657-22. This is an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending Chapter 2, Article 2, Section 25 of the Carmel City Code. Sponsors are Councilors Ryder, Worrell, Austin, Finkham, Nelson, and Campbell. This remains in a committee of the whole. I am tossing out the date of February 28th in this room at 5:30. So if each of the councilors would let me know if you are unable to meet, and I will let the appropriate other people that we need to have at the meeting know about that. Item 12B, second reading of Ordinance Z-679-22, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending the Legacy Planned Unit Development District, Z-501-07. Sponsors are Councilors Ryder and Austin. This returns from the Land Use and Special Studies Committee. Councilor Campbell.
Thank you, Mr. President. Again, this is coming back with a 4-0 favorable recommendation from the committee. And several councilors also joined the discussion with the committee members. Several items were discussed during the meeting, primarily concerns that we heard from constituents. We discussed traffic concerns. Constituents have expressed concerns about potential increased traffic, but the petitioner explained that there will be a 41% decrease in traffic by right or opposed to what could be built there. We also discussed the potential effect on schools, the fact that enrollment is declining beginning with the elementary schools, so this project won't be a burden to the schools. This is considered a non-standard product, and I admit I wasn't completely on board with this at the beginning. Couldn't really wrap my head around the concept, but the petitioner did a great job meeting with counselors, addressed all of our concerns, and said yes to everything that we asked for. Therefore, I move that we approve Z-679-22.
Second.
All right, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion regarding this before we take a vote? Councillor Finkham.
I want to first thank the petitioner and everybody involved because we had tons of meetings and the first couple weren't exactly what I would chalk up under the fun category. We have five HOAs in the legacy area and a couple were bordering on combative a couple times. So thank you for the petitioner and for some of the counselors that came out as well. You know, I think we always have to make sure we do everything we can to listen to the constituents, even when that may not feel super good for anybody involved. This project evolved greatly from start to now, and Laura indicated the petitioner's done a fabulous job, pretty much saying yes to almost everything. It's better architecture, it's better layout, better use of commercial space. We'll have a wonderful midtown-esque area, hopefully on the corner there when it's built. And we were able to demonstrate, due to investment on the petitioner's part in doing a traffic study, that traffic increase will absolutely be minimal. Schools won't be impacted. They made an investment in, because this isn't truly an urban area, made an investment in raised crosswalks through the area. And then the city is also matching that on Community Drive, regardless of this project coming in, to help make sure we're really safe around that play school area, which is of utmost concern. Of the HOAs involved, there were two that I could not get passed into a positive area. These are the two that are most directly impacted, and their primary concerns many of their concerns were addressed. The two that they could not be addressed were the use, that this is a build-to-rent project, and they wanted a reduction in the number of units and an increase in the commercial space. And the petitioner clearly said, we don't believe increased commercial space here is viable based on the other commercial uses across the street and some that are proposed to come into Conner Prairie. But because of those two HOAs being strongly opposed, I am a no on this project. But I want to thank the petitioner for everything they did, because if this goes through, I do believe this is a quality project.
Councilor Finkham, do you know, I was out of the country when the land use met. How did they handle the connectivity between the different neighborhoods?
I'm not on the land use committee, so
okay.
That would be Laura.
Laura, do you remember how that was handled?
I'll defer to the petitioner.
Specifically regarding vehicular connectivity between this
yeah.
and the adjacent sites, that there are multiple connections through the existing roadway network in the Legacy, as well as an additional cut onto 146th Street. But all the streets that connect, that are extended today into the site, will connect through and run through the proposed development.
Okay, very good. Thank you. All right, are there any other questions? Councillor Austin.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just wanted to reiterate thanks to the petitioner for all your work you did, both with neighbors, but also talking to the Plan Commission and the Council. It's been great working with you. I do want to echo the sentiments. My daughter goes to that day school, play school right there. And even without this project, it's already, you've got unaware parents rushing their way to work, kids crossing the street, people cutting through the area, and then now we're going to be constructing right on top of that. So thank you for the raised crosswalks. I would reiterate what I said at land use. Community Drive's great. Maybe we should keep a look at Equality Boulevard, too, that right in front of the play school with the development right happening right there. I think it's a great project, and I appreciate all the work you did to explain the difference between this project compared to what was already available to do by right if we did nothing. And I think that everything is mostly equal, if not improved, with this project compared to what was available by right. Thank you.
Okay. Any other additional questions? All right. We will call for the question. Please cast your vote. All right. This motion carries 8-1. Okay. That motion passes 8-1. All right, thank you to the petitioner and everyone involved. We will now move on to item 13A, which are public hearings. I'm going to read in the first readings on these public hearings. We are going to get an introduction. I've assigned all those. We will get the presentation, take questions by council, then we'll have the public hearing. First one is first reading of Ordinance Z680-23, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, rezoning Rosie's Gardens. Sponsors, Councilors Green and Austin. Do I have a motion to introduce?
Move to introduce.
Second.
All right. Who would like to read the, Councilor Green, will you please read the synopsis?
An ordinance changing the zoning of approximately 14.63 acres of land located at 10402 North College Avenue from the R1 district and the B1 district to the B3 district classification, removal of 2.47 acres from the business district subarea of the Home Place Overlay District.
Okay. Who will be making the presentation on this one?
I can go. Mike, I think you're the only person from DOC here. Yeah, go ahead. All right.
All right, if you'd please tell us who you are and what your relationship to this project is, please.
Yes, good evening. For the record, Andy Wirt, land use professional with the law firm of Church Hill and Antrim, with offices at 2 North 9th Street in Noblesville. Also here tonight are the Hughes family, Kevin and Mary Beth, and their daughters Rose and Emma, and Kathleen Bowes from our firm, an attorney for our firm as well.
Okay, very good. Why don't you give us an overview of the request, and then we will get into questions from council.
Sure. I'm sure you're all familiar with Rosie's Gardens. It was started by Kevin and Mary Beth back in 1982. We're before you seeking approval for a change of zoning for approximately 14 acres at 10402 North College Avenue. Rosie sits on a total of about 15 acres. There is one parcel that is already zoned B3. That's where the existing store is. There are two other parcels that are zoned B1. The balance of the property is zoned R1. So the idea is to get the entire property consolidated under one zoning district. We were before the Plan Commission on December 13th, and then we were in front of the Commercial Committee last month. We have modified our original petition regarding the withdrawal from the Home Place Overlay District to removal of just the property from just the business district subarea. This, in addition, of course, to changing the underlying zoning to B3. The purpose behind the zoning request is an expansion proposal. We have plans to expand the existing parking as we need. We're in need of a more on-site parking. We plan to replace the existing store with a larger one. We have some drainage improvements that will be needed. So we'll be adding, dry detention and a couple of new storage buildings and also some landscaping buffering to the south. There will be some existing drive cuts will be eliminated and I believe one added. Kevin's been coordinating this with the engineer overseeing the ongoing College Avenue project. We do believe that keeping the overlay in place offers the best long-term protection for our neighbors. Certainly addresses one area of concern that the city had. It will leave us with the need to seek a couple of variances from the Board of Zoning Appeals, specifically for the existing outdoor displays, as well as a parking lot setback. And as we progress with the details of our expansion plans, we'll be filing these. So we've received many supportive comments from neighbors, from the Plan Commission, from staff. We're very appreciative of all those. This location has been home to Rosie's for many years now. We're anxious to move forward with our plans, which we believe will be very beneficial to the neighborhood.
Yeah, very good. Just for the record, for anyone that may be watching that doesn't know where Rosie's place is, could you give the address or description? Might as well make it a commercial while you're at it. No, I'm just kidding. But give the location.
10402 North College Avenue.
Yep. All right. Are there any questions from council before we go to public hearing? Councilor Austin.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just wanted to note that at the Plan Commission level, especially in the Commercial Committee, this was pretty non-controversial. There was neighbors that spoke in support of the project. And I will add that Rosie's has been a really good community neighbor to the Home Place area, and we're excited to see that they're expanding and staying here in Carmel. So thank you.
Very good. All right. Any other questions? Okay, let's move to the public hearing. We're going to open the public hearing at 7:12. Anyone that wants to speak either for or against, if you could please make your way to the podium, and you will be given 3 minutes to speak. I see no movement, therefore I'm going to close the public hearing at 30 seconds later. And do I have any action or a motion? Do you, does council want this to go to committee, or is there?
I would move we suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
Okay. All right. It's been moved and seconded to suspend the rules, which means we would then take action. Is there any further discussion? All right. Let's go ahead and cast our votes for that. All right. That is unanimous.
Mr.
Now,
President?
Just one moment, Councilor Ryder. I just want to make sure, does department have any comments? Sounds like everything was well received. Everything was positive. Anything we need to know before we cast this vote?
Thank you. Mike Hollibaugh, Director of Community Services. So this is step one of the overall effort. And so they'll be back before Plan Commission for DP development plan approval and ADLS approval, you know, the trip to the BZA. So there'll be ample opportunities for the public to comment and for the review and fine tuning of the project. And
very good.
It was very well received. Unanimous vote to send it here. And yep, we're all thrilled with the cleanup here.
That is great to hear. Okay, any other questions before I open it up to a motion? All right.
Mr. President.
Councilor Ryder.
Before I make the motion, I just want to call it, Rosie's is one, it's your homegrown. This is what we like to see in our community. So, and like I told you, you're a hobby for my mother-in-law. Move to approve.
Okay.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, please cast your vote. That is unanimous. Thank you very much. All right, we will now move on to item B, first reading of Ordinance D 2662-23. An ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, authorizing and approving an additional appropriation of funds from the operating balance of the general fund to the 2023 Department of Community Services budget. Sponsors are Councilors Austin, Finkham, and Ryder. Councilor Austin?
Move to introduce.
Second.
All right. This ordinance appropriates funds received from the Hamilton County Recorder's Office for lien payments that were deposited in the general fund into the 2023 Department of Community Services budget.
All right. Will we be receiving a presentation on this from Mr. Oberlander, since I see him getting up?
Thank you, President Worrell. I'm happy to answer any questions on this. This is an ordinance that the council typically passes a couple times a year. This is money that's received mostly from weed liens, from code enforcement activities. So receive the money from Hamilton County, gets deposited into the general fund. This is going to appropriate it back into the DOCS budget so that money can then be spent on further code enforcement activity.
Okay. All right. Any questions for Mr. Oberlander? Okay. I will now open up the public hearing at 7:16. Anyone that wants to speak either for or against this ordinance, please make your way to the podium. Seeing none, I close the public hearing 20 seconds later.
Councilor Ryder. Suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to suspend. Any discussion? Please vote. Is there a motion?
Move to approve.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Please vote. And that is unanimous. That carries. We're now moving on to item 14A, which is new business. First reading of Ordinance D 2663-23, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, amending Section 8-37 of the Carmel City Code. Sponsors are Councilors Austin, Finkham, and Ryder.
Move to introduce.
Second. All right. go ahead and read the synopsis, please, Councilor Austin.
This ordinance establishes a 15-minute loading zone on Veterans Way in front of the new Carmel Fire Department headquarters.
And I see Chief Hobbush making his way to the podium to present.
Hi, good evening, Council. Thanks for the opportunity to come before you this evening. As you are all aware, the fire department will be moving into its new headquarters located at 210 Veterans Way, which for people in the audience here is located just on the backside or the west side of the Indiana Design Center. That's the original home of the original fire station that was built in 1960 by the volunteers. And so that is sacred ground for the firefighters and for the fire department. And so we're excited about moving back into this location. The reason that we're asking for this out in front of the new building is part of this building on the first floor is going to be a safe house, S-A-F-E. Stay Alive Family Education is the acronym. If you're familiar with Survive Alive in the past, that's what we've called our education program. We found out that that was actually trademarked, and so we decided to do our own thing here rather than infringe upon that. And so part of this is that we partnered with the schools to bring the children to us. And so it will be a permanent learning facility for the kids in our community. And so we're looking for that area out in front of this building to serve as a bus loading and unloading zone out in front. And I'm happy to take any questions.
All right, Council, any questions? I'm looking for a motion.
Move to suspend the rules and act on this evening.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? Please vote. That carries.
Move to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? Please vote. What's the projected move-in date?
Furniture is on order right now. It should start arriving the beginning of March. And so I hope that we have the administration in the new building late March. The museum, and which is also going to be located on the first floor, and the safe house will be, it's going to take several months for us to get into the building for that. So we hope this summer to have a grand opening and a community event there and lots of tours of the building, so we're very excited. But the administration is looking for the end of March for us to actually move into the building, so it'll be very exciting.
All right.
Thank you.
Use that loading zone wisely.
We will do so. Thank you.
All right. We will move on to item 14B, first reading of Ordinance D-2664-23, an ordinance of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving an increased cost of living adjustment for 2023 Carmel Fire Department Emergency Medical Services fees. Sponsor is Councilors Campbell, Worrell, and Ryder. Looking to Councilor Campbell.
Move to introduce.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. President. This approves an 8.75% cost of living adjustment for emergency medical services fees charged by the Carmel Fire Department in 2023. And Chief Hobbush is at the podium.
Thank you, Councilor. For members of our community that don't know, the Carmel Fire Department and firefighters run our ambulance transport service here in our community. We respond on approximately 6,500 to 7,000 EMS runs in our community per year. the actual bill, it is a user fee for the people that actually are transported to the hospital by the Carmel Fire Department. Those funds come in and they go into a non-reverting fund that is overseen by the fire department. That fund has very specific language on what it can be used for. And a general overview is training costs for the department, safety equipment, so SCBA, self-contained breathing apparatus, is something that we're going to be purchasing here in the next year. You will hear about us talk about this in our budget, and then also fire equipment. To give you an idea of what's taking place here over the last few years, some of our suppliers are seeing increases of 15%. And so you add 15% onto a fire truck or a ladder truck, or $1 million for SCBAs for the firefighters. That's a big chunk of money. That money's coming out of the ambulance fund. So I'm here this evening to ask for an 8.75% increase to the actual costs, the user fee that's paid for ambulance transport. That number does sound big, but that's not a random number. That number is supported by Medicare and Medicaid, which is the federal government, and that is actually what they have increased their reimbursement rate for 2023. Last year, I was here before this council as well, asking for a 5.1% because that was the increase from Medicare and Medicaid as well. Historically, this council, a previous council, had built in a 3% cost of living annual percentage increase so that the fire chief didn't come before you and it was just built into the system. We are in unprecedented times, and so that is how we came up with the 8.75% increase, and I'm happy to take any questions that you may have.
What are you looking for in the way of timing? Can you speak to that, please?
I would ask that this council this evening act upon this or consider acting upon this. We've been intentional about not sending out bills since January 1 of 2023, so that if someone was transported to the hospital on January 1st, they are paying the same amount as someone who would be transported on March 1st. So our ambulance billing department has been working diligently with the hope that the council would approve this 8.75% this evening. And so we will go back to January 1, and everyone who is transported in 2023 will pay the exact same amount of money.
Okay. Thank you for that, Chief.
Thank you.
Councilor Hannon.
I just want to say thank you for explaining where the numbers come from. I do remember the conversation last year as well, as you said, unprecedented times, but it's clearly indexed to Medicare and Medicaid, and again, I think it's absolutely the right thing to do, so thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Nelson.
Move to suspend the rules and vote on this evening.
Second.
Okay. Or is there any further discussion? Councilor Finkham.
This question's for John, really. We don't need to actually specifically state this is retroactive to January 1. It says in 2023 in the words. I just want to ask that question since this will be dated later.
Thank you, Councilor Finkham. No, I think the language in there is sufficient because okay. It covers all of 2023.
I read that. I just want to make sure, right? So we didn't go through this for nothing. Thank you.
All right. Please vote.
Move to approve.
Okay, that carries. Yep, go ahead. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. Any further discussion? Please vote. And that is unanimous. Okay. Thank you, Chief. Thank you for being here tonight. Let's move on to Resolution CC-0206-2301. This is a resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving certain matters in connection with the establishment of the 111th Penn Redevelopment Area, which we'll call the 111th and Penn. Sponsors are Councilors Ryder and Worrell.
Move to introduce.
Second.
All right, Councilor Ryder.
Resolution approves a resolution of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission establishing the 111th Penn Redevelopment Area, including a redevelopment plan for the redevelopment area, and two, a related Carmel Plan Commission resolution.
All right. I believe everybody received a kind of an email description from Director Mesteski. So if there's any additional questions, now's the time. Do you want to present on this one?
I would like to, Councilor, if that's okay.
Okay, sure.
In case Council chooses to suspend the rules and vote on these items tonight.
We will. Resolution, we will. They will be voted on tonight.
Okay. I wanted to, vote on them tonight instead of potentially send them to committee. I just want to take a moment for anybody watching, if this is new to somebody, and just for a second explain the difference between TIF bond votes and allocation area votes.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. Go ahead.
So generally when TIF projects are brought before City Council votes on two separate matters. One is a TIF bond, allowing a TIF bond to occur. In all these cases, these are obviously bonds that are developer bonds where the city's not on the hook. TIF bonds are, when those projects are brought, that's usually the one that comes with great fanfare. They are always sent to committee. They're always dissected at committee, sometimes through multiple committee votes. I mean, that's really the big political question. Would the council be comfortable with the project as presented? Last time on some of these, we had developers come. I mean, you always have developers come and speak. Last time we had conversations about impact to the schools. We had conversations on, you know, how many kids live in some of these units. This is what usually makes the news, and there is a lot of conversation that go on when we're dealing with TIF votes. As part of that TIF process, the state statute also lays out the actual creation of the allocation areas over the land that would then fund a TIF bond if there's a TIF bond. These are more administrative in nature. It's part of a pretty cumbersome process laid out by state statute that requires a redevelopment commission vote, plan commission vote, city council vote, and then back to a confirmatory resolution at redevelopment commission again, where there's a public hearing all pursuant to state statute. This process usually takes months. During this process, a developer cannot transfer land, a developer cannot replat, or else it messes up the whole process. And usually council votes on these without sending them to committee. And so if council chooses that to do that here, I don't want anybody thinking that this is, none of this has been kind of thought out. This is something that council takes a long time to consider. With that, the first area is this is a creation of redevelopment area. This is the 111th and Penn project. That was the $700 million investment that created multifamily and commercial and for sale residential. We will come back later this year and create specific allocation areas that match phasing of construction on this project. But this is the creation of the redevelopment area. Other than sending council a general description, I do want to note that Bruce Donaldson from our bond attorney from Barnes and Thornburg is here to answer any questions that I can't answer that the council may have.
Okay. All right. Do you have the details on this, and is your plan to put details of these kind of projects at this stage on Choose Carmel, Indiana?
Perfect. This project itself is not on Choose Carmel, Indiana just yet, but I want to give an opportunity one more time for anybody watching. If they want to learn generally about redevelopment projects, to go to choosecarmelin.com, and you can generally learn about these projects. We wanted the developer to get a little further into architecture.
The reason I ask, in the spirit of full transparency, this is a great tool. It's already been brought to my attention by several people I just got an email about it this afternoon. So I just want to encourage you, as soon as it's appropriate, when we're talking about it, to be able to send someone to choosecarmelin.com and they can get the details. Please do that.
I'll make sure to do that. Thank you, Councillor.
Okay. All right. Very good. Thank you. Is there any questions for Director Mosteski on this?
Move to approve.
All right. Is there a second? Okay. Let's get a second. Then we'll do further discussion. Did I get a second?
Second.
Okay. All right. Now, Councillor Hannon.
Thank you, Mr. President. So, Director, just with creation of the allocation district, at what point do taxes start to flow into the TIF district? So typically, even though this is an allocation district, unless CRC has purchased the property, during all of this development period, the base tax still flows to the coffers, right? So again, the timing of the creation of the allocation district does not immediately change tax flow to the general fund, correct?
That is correct. I believe taxes start flowing after a confirmatory resolution is created, and again, taxes are paid twice a year. So after it goes through this four-step process, then there's after a confirmatory resolution, then the next half a year cycle when taxes are paid, that's when it would begin.
Okay, Councilor Green.
Yeah, Henry, could you just kind of very briefly explain, several of us voted against the TIF bond originally. What's the consequence of voting against a resolution? Isn't, like you said, it's more of a formality, a process.
I would say that the Central Indiana community, really the state as a whole, business leaders, investors, developers, people that build, pay attention to city processes. And the reason why we come before city council with a kind of a TIF request, usually when that happens, is the statute sets out a fairly cumbersome process of all the things that have to happen. And I believe that once the city council approves a TIF bond, there's almost an imperative that the city council, that the city will see through, will see the project through. Usually the creation, the passing of the TIF bond is what gets developers to start spending, you know, money on architecture, on design. Here on this specific project, they only purchased the property after the TIF bond was approved. Oftentimes that really gets past the entitlement process, starts the entitlement process in the beginning. So this I think the effects of us as a city saying we support this project one moment and then pulling back the mechanism for it to be effectuated would potentially be catastrophic. I think the city of Carmel has always been a very efficiently run government, and it would just be I think it would signal to developers not to trust the city's process if something like that would occur. But that is my personal opinion, and I just one person's thought.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay, are there any additional questions? All right, we have a motion on the table to approve resolution CC 02062301. Without any further discussion, please vote. Okay, that passes 8-1. So that is approved. All right. We'll move on now to resolution CC 02062302, a resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving certain matters in connection with the Old Meridian Economic Development Area, ERS Old Meridian, and Main Allocation Area. Sponsors are Councilors Ryder and Worrell.
Move to introduce.
Second.
Okay, that's been moved and seconded. Please read the synopsis.
Resolution approves a resolution of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission creating new ERS Old Meridian and Main Allocation Area within the Old Meridian Economic Development Area, including an economic plan supplement and a related Carmel Plan Commission resolution.
All right, Director Misteski.
This is the ERS Old Meridian project that Council previously approved the TIF bond on. There's it's a multifamily project. There are stacked flats, for sale flats, that line Main Street, and there will be a public plaza in the center. If Council remembers, there was a previous right-of-way vacation that once this, if Council chooses to grant this allocation area, it will join the allocation area and join the project, just at the corner there at the roundabout. That was a couple months ago.
Okay. All right, are there any questions?
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion to approve. Any further discussion? Please vote. Okay, we have 9-0. That is approved. Resolution CC 02062303, a resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving certain matters in connection with the Old Town Economic Development Area. This is 3rd Avenue AT&T Allocation Area. Sponsors are Councilors Ryder and Worrell.
Move to introduce.
Second.
Okay, and the synopsis, please.
Resolution approves a resolution of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission approving an expansion to the Old Town Economic Development Area and creating a new 3rd Avenue ATT allocation area within the expansion area, including an economic development plan supplement and a related Carmel Plan Commission resolution.
All right, take it away.
This is the $133 million investment that includes a new Buckingham multifamily project and a 80,000 square foot expansion of Merchants Bank. I did want to correct, or not correct, but just elaborate more for the record. The resolution reads as an expansion of an economic development area. There's an old Councillor Hannon and I had a chance to talk about this earlier today, so I just wanted to make sure anyone listening just kind of understands that the Old Town Economic Development Area pretty much blankets all of Main Street and our Midtown area, but really the only thing that's truly being created is this specific allocation area. You will also note that even though the project brought before City Council originally had those two residential lots, they are not part of this creation of this allocation area today.
All right, thank you. Any questions? Yes, Councillor Hannon.
Yeah, just again to add on to what Director said, the language I thought was a little confusing, and the concern was that somehow you're going to expand what was already presented. In fact, you've pulled it back because I think BZA voted against the lot splits, or what was it?
That is correct.
That withdrew that part of that. So
that is correct.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, it was a good question, Councillor Hannon, today. All right, do I have a motion?
Move to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right, any further discussion? Let's vote. All right, that is, I have one more to go. Councillor Finkham, do you want to cast your vote, or do you want to?
Good. I can if you want. But
let's go ahead, since you're there.
Aye.
I'm restarting.
Okay. All right, that is 8-1. That motion carries. All right, we are now moving to resolution CC-02-06-2304, resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving certain matters in connection with the integrated 126th Street Corridor Economic Development Area, Crossing 1 Allocation Area, and Crossing 2 Allocation Area. Sponsors are Councilors Ryder and Worrell.
Move to introduce.
Okay, synopsis.
Resolution approves a resolution of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission.
Resolution approves a resolution of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission creating new Crossing 1 Allocation Area and new Crossing 2 Allocation Area within the integrated 126th Street Corridor Economic Development Area, including an Economic Development Plan Supplement and a related Carmel Plan Commission resolution.
All right, Director.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor. This is the Republic Training Center / Headquarters allocation areas being created. Council has previously approved this project. It includes 1,900 jobs as part of this move of Republic to Carmel from Indianapolis and across the country.
All right. Do I have a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay. Are there any questions? Any concerns? All right. Please vote. And that's 9-0. Thank you. All right. We will move on now to resolution CC-062305, a resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving certain matters in connection with the North Illinois Street Economic Development Area Bridges 2 Allocation Area. Sponsors are Councillors Ryder and Worrell.
Move to introduce.
Second.
Okay, synopsis.
Resolution approves a resolution of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission creating new Bridges 2 Allocation Area within the North Illinois Street Economic Development Area, including an Economic Development Plan Supplement and a related Carmel Plan Commission resolution.
All right, Director.
Thank you, Councillor. This is a project that does not have a TIF bond at this point. Sometimes these areas are created at the same time that a TIF bond is brought. Sometimes they're done way after a TIF bond is brought, and sometimes they're done before, just strategically. One of the things being negotiated here is the TIF would fund at least a $400,000 roundabout that would be built in the middle there between the two roundabouts on 111th Street. And there's not a TIF bond at this time.
Is this medical? No.
This is there's a medical office on the east side of this project.
Okay, Councillor Hannon.
So was Bridges 1 a TIF or not?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Any additional questions? I'll take a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right, any further discussion? Please vote. All right, this one is 8-1, so that passes. We'll now move on to resolution CC02062306, a resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving certain matters in connection with the North Illinois Street Economic Development Area, Franciscan North Allocation Area. Sponsors are Councilors Ryder and Worrell.
Move to introduce.
Second.
All right, synopsis, please.
Resolution approves a resolution of the Carmel Redevelopment Commission approving an expansion to the North Illinois Street Economic Development Area, creating a new Franciscan North Allocation Area, including an Economic Development Plan supplement and a related Carmel Plan Commission resolution. Anybody else feel like Groundhog Day?
Thank you, Councillor. This is a expansion of the Franciscan Allocation Area. If you remember, there was a Franciscan hospital that was built just to the south of this. One of the things that we negotiated in that project agreement was that that garage was probably overbuilt by that for that project by about 200 spaces, knowing that it would also park the use to the north, and that when it made sense, we would bring in that further allocation area. There is not a TIF bond request at this time, but the creation of this area was contemplated back in the beginning when the first Franciscan Hospital area was first created.
All right, any questions? Yeah, Councillor Campbell.
I do have a question about the timing. Why is all of this hitting tonight? It's a lot for on the agenda, and I just wondered what the timing is for. Is it just coincidental, or how did this come about?
Councillor, as much as I try to, I want to just not have a bunch of things every single council meeting, and if I can put them all together out of expediency and just efficiency, I try to do that out of respect for council.
Would you rather have them? I mean, I can kind of maybe help manage that if you think they should be spread out.
Yeah, I think they should. It just seems like we're just passing a lot, and it just seems, I'm not saying we should hold them over, but it just seems a lot for one meeting, and I just think it'd be better if we did space these out better than just cramming them all in one night.
All right. Good advice. As president, I will try and do a better job of spacing these things out. So,
I need the help of the clerk. I can do that. That's not a problem. I thought this was more convenient.
Yeah, it's good feedback. Councillor Hannon.
On this particular area, since a bond has not been set, what is that area currently zoned? And what's the, is this going to be another medical campus, or do we know what the plans are right now?
This is currently zoned commercial, I believe. You remember that's that neighborhood that they took down one house at a time and rezoned it all as commercial.
Good training for our police and fire, right?
Yes.
Okay.
That is correct.
All right, any other questions? No.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right, without further discussion, please vote. We have 9-0, that passes.
Thank you, Council.
And we are now on to resolution CC02062307. This is a resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, transferring funds from the General Fund 101 to the Rainy Day Fund. Sponsors are Councilors Austin, Finkham, and Ryder. I'm looking to Councilor Finkham.
Thank you. All choked up there for a second. This transfer is $1 million. Move to introduce.
Second.
This transfer is $1,034,292 from the General Fund to the Rainy Day Fund pursuant to Carmel City Code Section 2-110, Subsection D, which requires that the Rainy Day Fund balance on January 1, 2023 must equal or exceed 10% of the 2023 General Fund budget adopted by the Council in 22.
All right. John, did you have any legal statements you want to make about this? It seems pretty straightforward, but does the Council have any questions?
Mr. President?
Yes.
I could add to, we passed this, I believe, in 2019. I introduced an ordinance that said this had to be the case, and you see the wording here says must equal on January 1, 2023. We had robust discussion that this could not bind future councils to do this. They had to vote for it every year. So this is what makes that happen.
Yep. And that's why I look to you to introduce this, because of your work on this. So thank you very much.
Move to approve.
Second.
All right, any further discussion? Okay, please vote. That is 9-0. That passes. And we are at resolution CC02062308. A resolution of the Common Council of the City of Carmel, Indiana, approving the suspension of the short-term residential rental ordinance during certain periods of the year. Sponsors are Councilors Austin, Finkham, and Ryder. Looking to Councilor Austin.
Move to introduce. Second. This resolution approves dates submitted to the mayor for the suspension of the Unified Development Ordinance Section 5.72, short-term residential rentals, in 2023.
All right. Do you want to read those dates, somebody, or... should I read them? Should anybody read them? Do you have them, John, handy that you could read them into the record for us?
Yeah, I'd be happy to do that. So this would be the dates in this year when the short-term rental residential rental ordinance is suspended and people don't have to apply for a special exception through the Board of Zoning Appeals. So that would be April 8th and 9th, May 26th through the 30th, July 1st through the 4th, July 14th through the 22nd, August 11th through the 13th, September 2nd through the 4th, and December 1st and 2nd.
Excellent. Thank you. Is there any discussion on those? Councilor Hannon.
Just, John, just for the edification of anybody who might be listening, you know, what are these dates specifically tied to? Obviously, race weekend. What are the other dates in there?
Yeah, some of the other ones, Carmel Marathon, the Indy 500 just said, the Songbook Academy Week, the Big Ten Football Championship, and then 4th of July and Labor Day.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, do I have a motion?
Move to approve.
Second.
Any further discussion? All right, please vote. Okay, that carries. We have no agenda add-on items, other business, Carmel Audit Committee. Does anybody have, I am going to come back with a second try at a person, but if anybody has anybody, I would ask you to get it to me. We need to take action on this. We're looking for someone with financial skills, and the ordinance is pretty clear what must be done. Carmel Economic Development Commission term expires. That person, Jeff, has asked to be reappointed. So I'm going to ask the clerk to, isn't that who it is? Yeah. So I'm going to ask the clerk to make that happen. He would like to serve again. I would love to. Is everybody comfortable with that? I mean, you don't want to, okay. All right. Could I have a motion then to reappoint Jeff Maurer?
So moved.
Second. All right, it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All right, please vote. Are there any announcements? That motion carries. Any announcements? We are adjourned.
All he could do was direct traffic, and except for one man, and we called him the chief.